What's going on, everyone? Welcome to Season Gaming Bitcast, episode 286. Feels like it has been a long time since I've done this, probably because it has, but I hope all of you are doing well. I am your host, Ainsley Bowden, back in the saddle, back with Mr. Rodriguez, who has returned from New York, and the Hogue himself, of course, and we'll mention Travis here in just a moment. Gentlemen, how we doing?
I'm doing okay. I'm happy to not be in charge of the buttons this week. So I didn't blow anything up last week, folks. Thank you for sticking with me, but there were some obvious technical difficulties, especially at the end of the episode. So a lot of people had a lot of laughs.
I appreciated you hosting. Thank you for keeping the show going. The outro of last week was an all-time Bitcast moment, honestly.
Will you tell the people that you did not describe your outro as an outro? I'm not making this up. There's nothing that says extro or outro or anything.
Well, it does now. So in our streaming software, you have all these pictures and clips and everything you can have, and they're all labeled in different ways, right? And I just upload them in the way they're labeled on my computer, which happened to be, I think, like Season Gaming Intro for 2023, which is the intro for our normal channel stuff. But we use that as the outro too. It's just a 12-second, you know, little thing with the thing you see at the end of the show. Well, obviously, Hogue didn't realize that we use that for an outro too. So he accidentally played the world premiere joke clip that we have stored right after Travis said he was going to say some very hateful and mean comments. So if you missed the final like 45 seconds of last week's episode, I encourage you to check it out. It is also a short on this SG YouTube channel now, because it just had to be saved. It was brilliant.
That'll be played at my funeral, folks.
Oh, thanks. So it's good to be back. Travis, as you can see, is not with us today. So I don't know what I can say. Not much, I don't think. But in short, he is traveling internationally to cover a video game, an exclusive kind of premiere, world exclusive premiere that, you know, obviously he hasn't been able to talk about. So the nice thing here, of course, is Travis's role has expanded.
What? Why in the world?
Yes. Yes.
How bad is my audio quality? It's actually pretty good. Better than Hogue. Nice. Did you pay $8 for Wi-Fi?
I sure did, buddy.
My ears were ringing. I heard you talking about my travel plans, so you know.
Oh my god, dude, I'm in tears. We're listening to Airplane. For those on audio, Travis has joined literally via an airplane that is boarding. Yeah, he's
trying to figure out where he landed.
Yeah, I think it looks like he's getting ready for takeoff. They're kind of preparing there in storage, as you can see above him. Oh my god, I'm in tears. That's great. So anyway, as I was saying, Travis is traveling to cover a video game, an exclusive kind of premiere for IGN. Obviously, we're not talking about that, but he will be able to talk about that here in the coming shows. So hope you have a good trip, brother. Hope it's a great time. I'm looking forward to seeing what it is. Just to be clear, he has not told us what it is.
No.
Or anything about it, but we'll have more info on that soon. So
love you guys. Have a good show. Bye.
All right, man. See ya.
Get on airplane mode, dude.
Oh, dude, that was classic. Hilarious. Well played. He did not tell us he was going to do that, which is why I was laughing so hard. So sorry about that for our audio listeners. I'm sure that sounded like a train wreck. So apologies. So anyway, Travis is very excited, though. Apparently what he's covering is going to be a big thing. He said that it's going to be really cool to be able to talk about on the show, which is actually something I wanted to mention at the top, guys, because coming back, I was thinking about our show. I've been watching, obviously, a whole bunch of our peer shows, you know, a bunch of people we podcast with. One of the things I really have grown to love about our show, and this is obviously biased coming from me, right? But the fact that, you know, we do offer, you know, Travis gets a lot of kind of not inside info, but like, you know what I mean? Like actual industry info of things going on, new game releases, previews that he can talk about on the show. Hogue, obviously, you get the legal aspect of, you know, the things going on in the industry, the acquisitions, the mergers, the the buyouts, all those things that you don't get anywhere else. You know, I've been in the corporate world and application development for 25 years, so I talk about all that stuff. And I think it brings a really good perspective to the industry, which I'm very proud of. So I'm just going to pat ourselves on the back, guys, to get this show going. But I really like that about our show. So I thought I would just say that. And by the way, you get live broadcast from airplanes sometimes. Where else are you going to get that?
True. You do.
all right. So anyway, Travis not here this week. I did want to mention too, I want to shout out Mekel from last week, Casanova, my good friend from Hawaii there. Great content creator, great guy. Happy he could join the show. Obviously, my plan was to podcast with him last week. I didn't mention it on Twitter, but with our community here, knowing everyone. So if you weren't aware, my father passed last week. I had something else going on with the family for a couple of weeks, which is very tough to deal with, which is why I wasn't around. And then literally after that ended, my dad slipped into a coma 2 days after the other stuff I was dealing with. So I had to fly to California as an emergency. I was out there for 5 days. He passed on Tuesday. Shout out to my dad, but he obviously that threw a wrench into kind of everything going on for me and SG and the show. So Hogue, again, thanks for covering last week with Mekel. We will have him back on. Like I said, he's a great dude. And then just prior to that, the week prior, we were supposed to have my good friend Detective Seeds on as a guest. And no joke, the Saturday night before the show, his mom had a stroke. So it's just
it might be bad luck.
It has been a rough few weeks, not only for me, but some of the people I know and, you know, friends. So just as I said on my tweet, hug your loved ones. Don't take things for granted, because as Ho can tell you, too, after last year, you know, you never know what's going to happen. So
you really
don't take things for granted.
I'm glad you could get out there. It was my
I'm glad I went, too, because go ahead.
I did my best. But yeah, I didn't know our guest and I thought he was fantastic.
He's great.
And so yeah. I'm glad that you introduced us.
Yeah. Yeah. He's great. He'll be back. I've been talking to him this week. I said, dude, I'm back this week. Obviously, we have Easter next week, but he'll be back soon when we're all together and we'll have a good time.
Yeah. He had to put up with Travis and Rick by themselves. I mean,
yeah. I told him, I said, because, you know, he's seen our show, but I don't think he watches every week, right? There's just too many things going on. And I told him, I said, it's kind of known on Bitcast that Travis and Rick kind of have their own little back and forth a lot of times on our show. So, you know, it's quite funny. Anyway, and then lastly, before we get started, just to mention Easter, we've been going back and forth on whether we were going to do a show next week. We just prior to this starting decided we are not going to do a show next week. So, you know, I hope everyone has a happy Easter. There's things going on for the families. So hopefully the week after Easter, we'll finally, the four of us will be back properly as our normal cadence. I know it's been kind of a mess so far this year with travel and things happening, but we'll be back to normal soon. So, all right. I think that gets our housekeeping out of the way. We got a lot of games to talk about today. We're going to be talking about Dragon's Dogma 2, touch on Rise of the Ronin. Hogue, I'm hoping you can touch on Princess Peach Showtime.
I can.
Fantastic. We've got Travis asked us to talk about another little game we're going to talk about. I finished the Halo show season 2, which I want to talk about briefly. But I want to talk about this whole stupid microtransaction debate on Dragon's Dogma 2 as well. We'll get to that. Some stuff from PAX, like Final Fantasy updates. So we'll get to all that stuff. Before we do that, of course, let's get caught up on some of the memberships and super chats here. Dan, you're up, sir.
I'm ready. All right. Googleman coming in with €5. Bears in Space is a video game. Three Body Problem is a book, a Netflix show, and a physics thingy. A haiku. Was that a haiku?
It's not a haiku. That's true.
Okay.
Okay. Good job. We love you, Googleman. Bears in Space is the game done by like one of the people that worked on one of my favorite games a couple years ago, The Forgotten City. I'm looking forward to checking out Bears in Space.
Oh, is that their next game?
Yeah. Three Body Problem. I don't know if we're going to get a chance to talk about in this space. I will tell you that as someone that has been a big critic of D&D that ran Game of Thrones into the ground at the end, Three Body Problem is probably my favorite thing that I have seen in terms of intrigue and interest in a long time. I'm about halfway through that series, about 4 episodes into 8. And I highly recommend it. Check out Three Body Problem on Netflix, folks. It is real good.
Okay. I saw it. It looks weird, which means I'm immediately in. So added it to the queue. I will check it out. Bears in Space, I was not aware of. Forgotten City was an incredible game. So I'll have to check that out as well. Pretty cool. Googleman, thank you as always, brother. Jeremy Morton, excuse me.
Jeremy Morton, $24 super chat. Thank you very much. Good morning on the objectively greatest day of the year. So it's either Palm Sunday, he's referring to, and or
really loves Palm Sunday or his birthday. Birthday around
yeah,
here.
One of the two, I would say. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know what today is. Is today something special other than that?
I'm
obviously,
gonna say happy birthday, Jeremy.
Happy birthday,
no,
Jeremy.
I have no idea. I have no idea. So whenever that does happen.
Yeah.
I think you just put objectively in because Travis will lose his mind when he sees the word objectively in any context. That could be
too. He also did a $24 super chat, which one is generous. So thank you for that, yes. Jeremy. But it's the 24th day of the year. So we're going to go with birthday. We're going with it.
All right.
You just love number 24.
Yeah. Why not? And on top of that, even more generous, he gifted 20 SG memberships, which is that's crazy. So it's seriously, Jeremy, thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Yeah.
As Rick knows all too well, with me being out basically for the past month, missing Bitcast here and there, and I didn't do the other content I planned on, the channel has seen a big dive in its monthly, you know, aggregate viewership type things. So trying to get back into the swing of things. So as I always say, stuff like that helps tremendously. So thank you very much, Jeremy.
YouTube really hates when you stop. There's
Dude,
no question
it's
there.
It's terrible. Even a week. Like, if you take 1 week off of normal content, YouTube will bury you in the algorithm. It's really bad. So, Midnight Jury with a one season gaming membership as well. Always consistent, Jury. Thank you so much. Really appreciate that, as I was just saying. And then Rick Davis with the member comment.
Yeah. Morning, guys. What a last month of releases. Loving Rebirth. Pleasantly surprised by Rise of the Ronin. And tech aside, Dragon's Dogma 2 is awesome.
Nice.
Man, nice. Very nice. I played none of these.
Thank you, Rick. And so, what'd you say?
That's why I played none of these.
So oh, okay.
Far, I've been, I've been busy.
We'll talk about them.
Yeah.
So thank you all very much. Appreciate you. All right. Let's go ahead and get into it, man. So, yeah, let's where do we want to start? I can start on Dragon's Dogma if you want. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys are playing it as well.
Maybe
so
maybe we should do that one last. And
that's true. You know, yeah, good call. Good call.
I think we have a lot to talk about with respect to Dragon's Dogma. The one thing I have not seen anybody mention in this chat or really online that came out this week that I've been enjoying is the Alone in the Dark remake reboot. Yeah. I was talking about that last year. It was supposed to come out in October. They basically said it's done. Yeah. We're moving our date away from Alan Wake, which is probably pretty wise because it shares a lot in common with Alan Wake. But it is a reboot of the franchise that really was the progenitor to survival horror. If you don't know, Alone in the Dark came out in the 90s. It is what Resident Evil basically based itself on when it made its own game. And this particular version of Alone in the Dark has Hollywood celebrities, and I'm not going to remember their names. It's got the guy from Stranger Things, the sheriff, and it's got...
the girl from Free Guy. I can't remember her name either.
The girl from Free Guy / The Last Duel, Jodie Comer. And it's set in like the 1930s in the bayou at a mental institute where you're trying to figure out what's going on with puzzles on doors and things that made more sense in Alone in the Dark than they did in Resident Evil, but they worked, so they were put in Resident Evil. And it's quite good. I think the combat is not as tight as Resident Evil, which is probably one of the reasons why it's not getting as much coverage or as attention as that series. But for somebody that wants to go in to a haunted house and explore a lot of lore and background and figure out what's going on, it's really worked for me this week, in a week when there have been a lot of releases. So Alone in the Dark is worth checking out, but do note that it's not a combat, it's not a great combat game. Think of it more in the Silent Hill type of vein than in the Resident Evil.
Okay. Yeah, I saw, I don't know where it reviewed. I saw it was kind of getting middle of the road reviews and didn't know really what
I don't
to expect
doubt it.
Out of it. So,
yeah, it's a very old design. It really is show up at the house, wander around, look at notes and files, occasionally shoot a bad thing. But it's exactly what I was looking for from that kind of game. And so I think the lore is interesting. I think the background is interesting. I think there's a lot of good writing there. And I think the actors are probably a little wasted for what it is. It's a video game plot for the most part, but
yeah,
it's fine. If you think Hollywood actors can help your game, I don't have a problem with them. I recommend it.
Kind of an interesting choice to use them for that game for sure.
Yeah, and they have Jodie Comer. It is, I think, a British actress, and they have her with an American accent. So it's you can barely recognize it's her.
She is she the one from Peaky Blinders?
Maybe. I don't know. She's got that kind of voice. I saw her for the first time in the Last Duel, I think it was called.
Okay. All right, cool. Yeah, I was kind of curious how that one turned out. I saw the reviews, and you know, it's hard to say because, to your point, that type of game I don't think is ever going to review like nines. You know what I mean? It's just not what it
is. Not anymore. Yeah.
No. But you can still enjoy it. So that's good. That's good. All right, we got to do it, Hogue. Talk to us about Princess Peach. How the daughters enjoying it?
Showtime. The daughters are not actually playing it. I couldn't get them interested in playing it this week because Stardew Valley had a big update. And so they are both playing the Stardew Valley update. People that make video games understand that my girls love Stardew Valley above all other things. And that even if you make a really big Princess Peach video game, Stardew Valley update from like one guy in the Midwest is still going to win. So sorry about that. But yes, they were not playing Princess Peach with me. I was just a seasoned gamer sitting alone playing Princess Peach Showtime. make of that what you will, but I really enjoyed it. And I think it's a lot better than people were saying after playing the demo. The demo comes across as very simple. It's the first level of the game. It is kind of more in that Kirby or Yoshi type framework than it is a hardcore Mario type game. But it's got a lot of interesting things that are going on in it with respect to it being treated as a play and having different jobs or classes for Peach to do to get through these various levels. They've got a lot of secrets and a lot of things to collect. So it's a real old school kind of Mario feel. It's probably simpler than I would prefer, but I think it's very accessible to kids and families. So I think it's good. I think it's going to work out well for Nintendo. And I think that some of the criticisms I saw of it online earlier are probably a little bit unwarranted.
Okay. All right. I saw it reviewed pretty well for the most part for that type of game. Okay. Yeah, I figured I don't think me, Travis, or Dan were going to be talking about Princess Peach, but I figured you could cover it.
You do feel a little weird just sitting there and turning it on by yourself, but hey, this is what I do for you folks.
Yeah, fair enough.
For the show. For the show.
I will quickly mention, as I always do, of course, if you're not aware and you watch this show, you know I like a little game called Halo. So they had a big update this past Tuesday, which was an update, and the only reason I'm bringing it up, and I won't stay on it, I promise, is that if you weren't aware, they were basically rewriting the entire netcode for that game for like the past 18 months. So if you're not aware, like the kind of competitive, because Halo is such a competitive game, especially in the rank side, you know, you have to be very precise and things really matter. Like a single shot can make a big difference. And the network side of Infinite has not been great. You get blank shots sometimes, so you shoot someone and hit them, but it doesn't do any damage. Melees, you'll thunk someone and it won't register. You know, stuff like that has been going on since the game's release. So they've been reworking the entire network structure of the game for a very long time now, and it actually released on Tuesday alongside some other updates to the game, new maps and all that stuff, and it has made a huge difference, a positive difference. So it's really nice, you know, especially if you're someone who plays Halo consistently. The online experience, at least for me and many others, it seems, has been vastly improved, and it makes a big difference in playing it day to day. So, Rob, they didn't mention anything specifically. No, not in the details like you would want on what they changed, but it is highly, highly noticeable. I don't get the packet loss I used to get on PC and all those types of things. Ping fluctuations, blank shots are a lot, you know, you hardly see those anymore. So anyway, but a lot of new content as well. So if you enjoy that type of thing, I would definitely check it out. I would mention I was playing PUBG too. PUBG has a 7th year anniversary. That game's been out for 7 years, going on, and that's got all you know, content and special bonuses you can get as well, which has been pretty cool. So me living in that live service world, as always.
I am not. Yeah. I got so all these games come out. I'm in New York. I don't know what's going on. You know, I'm trying to, like, you know, decompress from the gaming stuff just for that week while I was gone. Mm-hmm. I come back and it's just like, this is too much. So I just bought MLB, and I'm sticking with something I know. I will wait on the other ones that all launched, and, you know, there's more coming. So, but it's my nice little safe house, I guess. I play Road to the Show, and that's about it. Nothing really changed. They didn't do really any improvements to the. They brought back a like the combine, which they had in it before, and they took it out for some reason. Now it's back, and that's about it. That's about everything else is pretty much the same. So that kind of sucks, but you know, it's about what I expect with sports games anymore. You know, they just kind of make these little improvements here and there,
small updates. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's it. So, they did, you know, keep the Negro Leagues thing going, which is nice. They also gave you the opportunity to play as a female character in, you know, you can create a female character for Road to the Show and bring her up. So that's nice. otherwise, like, actual improvements to the gameplay and, like, to the systems, not mm-hmm. anything. No, not really.
Wow. Yeah. That's a shame.
It's been like that for 3 years. So I'm hoping next year is like some kind of huge, you know, redoing of the whole system, but whatever. I still like playing it. It's relaxing for me.
Yeah.
I just, you know, I pick a pitcher, I do closer, and I can play, you know, through half of the season in like a couple hours. You know, it's really not that bad. So,
but nice. You're only playing when you enter the game.
Yeah. Yeah. And usually I'm playing for the Cubs, so I don't get in a ton. It's usually not for a save for sure. It's like, well, listen, we went through all the rest of our relievers. You're going to have to get out there. It's like, yeah, all right. You know, so, but yeah, that, and for some reason I'm back on Ghost of Tsushima again. It's because of Shogun. I mean, it's going to say it.
Yep. Shogun's really good.
It's so good. And like every time I watch it, I have to go back and play Ghost of Tsushima for like a few hours and just, you know, it's just so good. So good. So, but that's it. I haven't really been playing a whole lot. I've been out of town. So I'm interested to see what, I didn't even know anything about half of this stuff. Like the macro.
It's funny you mentioned the Negro Leagues, because we've talked before and kind of mm-hmm. explained that, because I realize you say that aloud and it sounds weird. And we've talked about that. Right. For people who don't know the history of baseball and what, but we have the museum here in Kansas City. And sure enough, like I said, I've kind of been flying around and came back. And they, in the new airport here, they have a big thing for visit the Kansas City Negro League Museum, which is pretty cool. So it made me think of our conversation. Yeah.
It's really nice.
Yeah, it's really cool. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll mention, and yes, we did miss the Tide picks. I saw people asking. I'll get to those in 1 second. So sorry about that. The other thing I'll mention is the finals. I did some coverage on season 2 of that. So Eric from SG, of course, were playing with Embark Studios in the preview of the finals 2 weeks ago. I didn't get to talk about it last week. Obviously, I wasn't here. So that's season 2 of that. It's it adds some really kind of interesting gadgets for the players in that, and kind of changes up the, you know, the structure of the game, new game mode, new map, all that kind of stuff you expect out of a new season for a big shooter like that. So just, there's so much, I don't know about you guys, but there's so many things to play. And I know we've talked about this, but not only like all these huge new releases that take a lot of time. You talked about Rebirth. I know Alex just finished Rebirth at 132 hours. Sure.
Alex has been a constant presence in my DMs as he discusses where I'm at in Final Fantasy VII Rebirth.
He's probably trying to tell you why it's like game of the year and the best thing ever, right? And explain to you.
No, he's very respectful of what I said last week, which is that I had complicated feelings about Rebirth. And I do think the middle of the game is very much not driven in terms of story or plot. It's getting a little bit more story driven towards the end here. And so he'll be in my DM saying, where are you at? Okay. Yeah. Make sure that you don't go past this point without this, or that you have your daughter with you, 'cause she's there for the story, and the game kind of lost her in the middle for this, but no spoilers, very friendly.
That's awesome.
Just definitely bopped into my DMs and was like, how you doing on that Rebirth? Like, I'm still on it. I'm still on it. It's a long game.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, from what I hear anyway. I mean, obviously I'm not playing it, but yeah, a lot of people, it's kind of interesting. I was asking the guys at SG about Rebirth the other day because I said I'm seeing more and more, at least on my timeline, people kind of saying the things that you did, is that it feels dragged out. There feels like there's a lot of fluff or padding. In fact, I just saw a tweet this morning saying, hey, I'm starting to feel like the original FF7 did a better job of storytelling than this new thing that they've created. So it's just, you know, I'm not playing it. I don't know. But I was just kind of asking the guys, because several of the guys at SG are playing, and I was like, what do you think? And Alex is obviously over here in terms of, like, he absolutely adores it. But I
think it's
know.
Very good. But I do think it is absolutely like the Hobbit movie trilogy of video game projects, right? Like, I don't think what I have said is that for this section of what they have translated into the remake project, I don't think they added enough actual plot or story or impetus to be moving forward. And so they just kind of magnified this relatively shortish period of time of the original game from disc one back in the day and didn't add enough drive. They added a lot of mini games. They added a lot of character beats, and a lot of people like those. One of the things that Alex said to me very early on a couple of weeks ago, and that you're now seeing a little bit more online, I saw this from Gene Park at the Washington Post, is that Rebirth reminds him of Mass Effect 2, where you have a lot more character beats and a lot more kind of outside plot world building that a lot of people connect to. And I think they did a good job with those things. But when you start the game and when you finish it 100 and however many hours later, you didn't have a lot of reason to be moving forward other than it's the next thing in the game. So
it's got that kind of Rebirth being. We can plan on it being the worst one of the three, is what you're saying.
We can plan
did
on.
You play Mass Effect 3? I mean, did you play Mass Effect 3?
Of course I did.
Okay, then did. Shut up. That's a terrible.
Mass Effect 3 was good. Go on. Oh my God. Good game.
Mass Effect 3 tied up things, had a big war. I think Mass Effect 3 is perhaps a little bit.
I think it's underappreciated
in people's opinions because the companions are not so good. But Mass Effect 2 lifts right out. You don't need that story at all. And those characters aren't touched on really importantly in Mass Effect 3. So it's a kind of a dead end to nowhere. That's not going to happen with Rebirth. This is your party. They're building up the characters because they're essentially adapting a novel that they already know, right? So I think that Rebirth is ultimately going to finish pretty strong. I think that's one of the reasons people like it. It's leaning that way now where I'm at in the game. But there was a huge chunk of time where I basically resented what it was doing. And so I can't discount that when I talk to people about Rebirth.
By the way, I like that you and I are here, the Mass Effect 1 stands. And we
Dan just opted out.
Yeah, we only have Dan to deal with. I think now's the time to strike. That's cool though. Yeah. I was talking with Alex earlier this week about Rebirth, but yeah, I mean, kind of where I started that conversation, right? With Rebirth being so long, Infinite Wealth being such a big long game as well. And Dragon's Dogma 2, Rise of the Ronin now, and then all these live service titles, you know, if you consistently play those, it's just you can't keep up with them all, man. It's really tough.
You cannot. Yeah, no, the big loser for me in this quarter of the year is Diablo 4 in terms of hours, because Skull and Bones has basically taken up that time, and then Rebirth. So it's Skull and Bones and Rebirth is what I'm playing. You heard me talk about Alone in the Dark. And then I'm also playing a game that I didn't get to talk about last week that I really love as a series. Now it's called Expeditions. It used to just be called Mud Runner or Snow Runner. Mm-hmm. But these are driving sim type games where you take cars and trucks off road and have to deal with a really cool engine that figures out exactly how much torque you have in your wheels. And you're hitting buttons like making them spin at the same rate and have the same power and all these various technological things that Ains, you probably know better than I do, but I'm hitting buttons on a controller to try to make it through the mud of Colorado or the Caspian Mountains. And it's gorgeous and it's sandboxy and open world. And I love this series to death and nobody really talks about it.
No, it does go under the radar. And Expeditions, this latest one, if I recall, is reviewed quite well.
I don't know the reviews. So, this is to tell you how much I'm not paying attention to the reviews, I have not seen the reviews for Alone in the Dark or Expeditions, except for whatever passes through my timeline on social media. So gotcha. I can tell you that I'm really enjoying Expeditions. You have to get into that mindset, almost like Dan talking about his baseball game. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to go in. I'm going to buy a couple trucks, and we're going to figure out how to get this third truck out of the mud. And that in and of itself is going to be fun. It's a true sandbox, right? Or mud box in this case. And that's the game I'm going to play. Okay. And I really enjoy that as a concept. I joke with my wife about going downstairs and playing with my trucks in the mud or sailing my pirate ship as being what I'm doing now, is I'm doing like these kind of traditional old guy activities. I'm going to just deal with heavy lifting machinery or pirate vessels. And that's what I'm going to do. So it's been a good time to just go and sandbox game. Rebirth is a fantastic sandbox because of the base of what they built in the 1990s. They have a lot more variety and willingness to be crazy in these towns and characters than they do in like Final Fantasy 16 or other stuff that they've made right now. So we live in like the sandbox utopia with all the things that we can do. But yeah, there's not enough time in the world to do all these things. So you got to pick your poison.
Yeah. You got to kind of pick a few and stick with it. I will mention Travis. So Travis is in the chat. He asked me to mention a game called Lil Guardsman, which I looked up this morning. So it's a puzzle game. Came out in end of January on all platforms. It's made by Hilltop Studios. I saw it was $20. Like I said, it's on all platforms. So PC, Switch, Xbox, PlayStation. Quite highly rated as well. So he was, I believe, recommending it. Travis, tell me if I'm off base here. But recommending that people check it out. Yeah. So that's pretty cool too. A lot of those types of games too. That's the other thing that I feel gets lost sometimes. Like, you know, you get those games like Balatro, right? That kind of break through the noise of the major releases, but there's so many other smaller games that release on a weekly basis that just get overlooked. It's kind of a shame, you know, there's just too much. All right. So let me talk about the Halo TV show, guys.
We don't have to.
I know. So I'll say this. If you didn't know, finale was Thursday of the season, 8 episodes again. The finale does some big things in terms of the Halo universe. I can definitively say this. It's better than season 1, without a doubt.
We can't use that as
I know.
Of measuring stick.
I know. I'm peeking out over the mud here. Hold on.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, for me, the problem is it's not competing with my time for season 1. It's competing with whether I should watch it or Three Body Problem.
Or anything else. Yeah. Yeah. And of course, I watch it because of Halo. So it had some really good parts. It does some better character building. It has better homages to Halo lore and the world. But it still makes some really weird choices. I'll just say this. I'll keep it short. You have to mentally separate yourself from what's in the games and what's in the kind of known Halo universe, for the most part, from what's going on in the show. It does some kind of big, grandiose things that are very different than what is traditionally in the game. But it also takes a lot of what's in Halo lore and kind of presents it in a different way. It's a weird show, man. I know that everyone I talk to really likes season 2 better, which is great again, but it still doesn't hit that kind of peak for me. I'm also watching like Tokyo Vice, Shogun, you know, those types of shows. And those shows are just so well done. It's just like, to Hoag's point, it's like, I don't get it. I don't really know what they were going for here, but hey, maybe I'm biased. I don't know.
No.
It's just hard to pick these video game adaptation projects over some other stuff that's really working well, right? So I saw like the trailer to the Fallout show on Amazon, and I didn't have the same problems with it that some on social media did. I thought it was an interesting clip, but it's not something that's going to drive me to go watch the show.
Okay. I am excited for that one. At least the trailer, I didn't have any problems with the trailer, but we'll see how the show's delivered, of course. I think the talent behind the show is huge on Fallout, which is exciting, but we'll see how they deliver it. So
well, it's got a Nolan. So, you know, we'll see what happens.
It's got a Nolan.
It's got a Nolan.
Put it on the box, folks. Dan Rodriguez.
Yeah.
It's got a Nolan.
I mean, Westworld was good, so maybe it's gonna be good. I don't know.
Westworld was good for a moment in time, and then it descended into chaos and anarchy.
That's exactly what I was just about to say. I liked Westworld a lot, and then all it just went off the cliff, and I was like, okay, you've lost me here. Man, what was I going to say? Rise? Oh, go ahead.
I'll say this about the Halo show. I think in season 7, it will be excellent. So if they're going by this trend, we're going to be hitting that season with like full on, you know.
Something. I'm not sure Paramount will exist as a studio for a season 7 of Halo.
We'll see. Yeah, that may be true. Maybe true. Yeah.
Sadly, none of the three of us are playing Rise of the Ronin currently. I figured one of these two guys had been playing it, but we haven't yet. I think that it's definitely one that I think all three of us will be playing at some point in time, but we're not yet. A couple of the guys I talk to regularly are playing it. If you're not aware, it kind of got reviews in the high sevens type range, you know, around that 8, which is pretty typical for Team Ninja. No, pretty typical for Team Ninja Project. I'm excited to check it out. It's just time. So I hope people are enjoying it. I know some of the guys I talked to that are playing it are enjoying it. I wish we could talk about it more, but I can't talk about it intelligently. So before we get to Dragon's Dogma 2 in our larger conversation, let me catch up with Tide's picks because we missed them. So she went with Dragon's Dogma this week. And we were joking before the show because Travis said it, and I was already thinking the same thing, is that I think that dragon is about to kill Travis.
He does look sad.
that dragon is holding that sword, and he's about to slice Travis. That's for sure.
I'm not sure that's what's going on there. I think maybe. I mean, yeah, either dragon is the, you know, the alpha in that picture for sure.
Oh, come
for
on,
sure. Man. All right. Yeah. So I don't know. We'll see. That was my opinion. You know.
The double mouth on Travis's dragon is horrifying.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You like that? Also, if you think about where Travis's arms are in this picture, there's no way he's holding that sword.
Yeah.
It just doesn't work.
Looks like he's surrendered to the, you know, to the whatever the dragon's about to do to him from behind. So
yeah,
we'll see what happens.
Yeah,
that's for next week.
A metaphor of some sort, I'm sure.
Yeah, there's something going on there. I really went above and beyond this week. So
I love that the dragon behind Hogue looks absolutely demonic, and yet Hogue has a smirk like he just found the game he's been searching for at Toys R Us or something.
I am smirking.
It's a very weird contrast between the two.
I smirk. That's what the AI knows about me.
Yeah, no doubt. Dan and I both look like it's an actual medieval painting of some sort, although I don't know why the AI continues to make me look more and more like Mer from Impractical Jokers.
You do. Just
I mean, that is Mer. That is 100% him. So
I look like the you know, I got that Danny Glover, I'm too old for this shit going on.
I'm not gonna lie, Dan, you look like you are a perfect cylinder that has a face painted on it.
Yes, it does. That's also real life. No neck. That's exactly what I look like.
That's great. At least Dan and I are holding the swords, because I don't know what's going on in Travis and Hoag's picks, honestly, because your arm doesn't really line up with where that sword is either, Hoag.
I mean, so. It'd be really weird.
I'm psychic. I'm just covering it in front of me.
Love it. Love it. Ty, thank you as always. Sorry I missed those at the start of the show, but you're awesome. Thank you very much. Okay. We got a super chat here to catch up on before we get to Dragon's Dogma. So shout out to Shush, who became re-upped on the SG side. Thank you, Shush. Always good to see you. And Mr. Don Lionheart is back.
Don, $5 super chat. How you doing, Bitcast? Up in New York City today for Sacred Symbols 300.
Oh, nice.
Celebration. Just landed. Flying back tomorrow, please. For my safety, am I right, Dan? Yeah. Here's the thing. I saw several news articles and videos about like the National Guard being in the subway and stuff. I saw two guys at one point, and that was it. They're doing like searches and stuff. The governor, I guess.
Okay.
You know, they're having problems down there. I didn't see any real issues, any normal, you know, outside of the normal New York City. Yeah, this is about right, you know, kind of stuff that I'm normally see. So it wasn't too bad. And I'll tell you what, you know, people maybe think that New Yorkers are kind of mean, or they're super nice. They're like the nicest people, man. I had one guy, like he had like a shirt on a hanger, and like we were waiting for a bus, and he's like, "Hey, man, they closed the bus lines." He He's like, you want to share a cab with me? You know, you guys come in here, I'll pay for it. I'll take you down to Rockefeller Center and this and that. But like, no, appreciate it. We can walk. But yeah, it was super nice. I mean, I had several people like that that were.
It's a misconception, I think. Especially I grew up near New York, obviously, and outside of Philadelphia, been to New York many times, and it's not that they are rude or hateful or anything like that. They're direct. No. They don't beat around the bush.
They don't have time.
And that is. No, and that is very different because now having lived in the Midwest for 13 years, it's very different if you come from the Midwest or the South or something, because it's very polite out here, but they definitely do beat around the bush, whereas New York, it just tells it like it is out of the gate, and that catches some people off guard. But it's, you know, I've never found them to be necessarily rude. They're just get to the effing point, you know, and don't waste my time.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of their walking structure either. I always feel like, you know, if you're on the right-hand side, you're walking one way, you're on the left, you're walking the other way. And then there's people that just, they're on their phones too much, New Yorkers. You guys need to get off your damn phones. I body checked like three people, including a small Asian woman that I felt really bad about, but I almost knocked her down. But she came out of nowhere. I was like, what are you doing? You know, I thought, this isn't going to work.
Came out of nowhere.
Dan's like 6'8". You know, he doesn't see people under like 5'10". You know what I mean? He doesn't see them.
She just flew. Like, all of a sudden, she's like on her phone. She just comes like jutting across at an angle. And I like literally shoulder checked her into the wall. I was like, what happened? She looked at me like I was like, hey, listen, I'm here, man. If you want, you're the one that needs to move. I mean, I'm not afraid of going through you. You know, that's not a big deal, but you know, hey.
Shout out to Sacred Symbols. Yes, they're doing their 300th episode live in New York today. I know Cog's up there and obviously the crew over there. So yeah, I hope that's a great show, Don. Thank you. He also added.
Also, Wahlburgers just opened on Long Island. Hype. Man, you have a very low standards, Don. No offense.
Yeah, Don, what are we doing, man? What are we doing?
If you're going to go to New York City. I think you see a familiar
face there, Don.
If you're gonna go to New York City, that is the last place you want to go. Except for TGI Fridays, don't go there. That's terrible. It's a terrible place. But you can do much better than Wahlburgers, probably within a block. I would say, you know, get some halal food.
Fridays was my teen hangout, man. That was we used to go to Fridays, and they had those like trivia games on the monitors, and me and my friends in high school would just go and win trivia games at Fridays.
Yeah, what we used to drink over there when I used to wait tables or the Fridays on the road. Rogue
brings to the table.
Trivia night of Fridays was your partying.
That's what we did. And we'd go to the Denny's or the Waffle House.
Fair enough. Wow. I'm going to leave my partying off the show for now. Yep. that's great.
Mine's a little bit different.
Wahlburgers. Don, I don't quite understand the super chat yet. I still appreciate it. So thank you.
Yeah. What do you think? Hope
you have a good time, Don. Thank you as always. All right. Let's talk some Dragon's Dogma, guys. So let's talk about the game first, and then we'll get into this microtransaction conversation lack of conversation. So I did pick up Dragon's Dogma. I've got a whole bunch of people I talk to regularly that are playing it. I saw a lot of comparisons to Elden Ring. For good or bad or indifferent, that made me more interested. I am very it's behind
just to get
on
you in
games.
The door, Ains.
I know. And it worked. So I did buy it. I'm playing it on PC. I know, you know, I don't know. There's all kinds of performance conversations I won't get into. For me so far, it's running great. I'm playing it in ultra wide at ultra everything. Obviously, I do have a new kind of high-end PC. So I'm not having any issues. I have seen some people having issues. I don't know, but
yeah, PlayStation 5. The thing is, it's mostly fine, but it does what I really hate in video games, which is that it just occasionally loses frames. So you get this kind of junky feeling all the time, even though mostly it's pretty smooth.
Okay,
and so that's what bugs me there.
Is there like different modes on the PlayStation?
There is not that I could find. It's just play the game.
Yeah, it's a 30 FPS, but it sounds like kind of like the what was that, the Jedi Survivor, when it launched, it had like the frames would just drop all of a sudden, you know, you'd go from like 50 to like 20, and
it's definitely unlocked. I think, I mean, it's fast, it's more than 30, it's closer to 60 on the PlayStation 5, but then it'll just have those, you know, the camera will pan and it'll just chunk along, and you're like, oh.
Okay, yeah. So I'm about, I'd say I'm about anywhere from 5 to 6 to 7 hours in, something like that. I'm still pretty early. Created my character, obviously, and my pawn. I'm enjoying it. I was talking to the guys yesterday, to guys that have, you know, 20 plus hours in it so far. And basically what I asked is does it open up? Is it full open world eventually? Because it begins with a lot of pathing, right? There's a couple hours where it's kind of just taking you down the straight path. There's obviously these little offshoots you can explore and stuff. But, you know, when you mention Elden Ring to me, of course, my mind is just give me this gigantic world and let me go do my thing. So I'm getting there. I've gotten to the first main city now, and I've got these quests to kind of go out and explore. I turned almost all the UI off. And I'm just kind of wandering around and checking things out, and it's becoming more interesting to me now. I will say that I do really enjoy, which I think, you know, there's funny clips on all over social media, kind of how it's just like an open physics model. You know what I mean? Like there's no real kind of lock on or specific ways you combat, like in a From game or other maybe combat games. You just kind of run around and there's people, there's just crap happening everywhere, right? There's spells popping off and you can kind of run freely in battle, and you can, you know, drag the big ogres down, you can jump off cliffs, you can throw things all over the place. And I think it creates this really, going back to your sandbox conversation or comment, Hoag, I think it creates this really cool kind of sandbox possibilities for combat, which is really, really neat so far that I'm enjoying.
Yeah, it feels really sandboxy. It feels really physical. It feels very, very much there. To not be able to articulate that better. You feel like you're in a location, and the physicality is very present in Dragon's Dogma. I do think that people say it's beautiful. It is in certain ways. It's also, it's not Rebirth. It's not terribly artistic. It reminds me of Dragon's Dogma 1, which was not a game that I connected to very well. It's very gray and kind of normal coloration and how we would think of looking at the real world, because it's trying to present that as kind of a real world with ogres.
Agree. Yeah.
And so I'm not sure it works super well for me yet, but I'm not anywhere in it as well. I have roughly the same feeling I had for the first game, which is this is cool. There's a lot of cool ideas of growing vocations and kind of having a job class for everybody and the pawns. To me, the biggest improvement seems to be that the pawns have gotten a big AI upgrade. Like they're doing a lot more stuff this time than they were in the first one.
Pretty competent, really.
If that's the only improvement, that's a pretty big one. And I can understand why people would like it. But it's still not that interesting of a place to be for me, right? Like you start off with this game and there's a dragon and you're arisen. And it's the same thing we've gotten in the last two Dragon's Dogma games. And okay, we're going to go now through this open world that is mostly a medieval type world with things that are vaguely interesting sometimes. But you're really there really to fight ogres.
You're selling me.
You're really there to fight ogres and throw barrels and things, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm kind of curious about, because I'm fighting a lot of goblins and harpies. And you know, there's an ogre once in a while or something bigger once in a while. But I'm waiting to see how it opens up. Obviously, the people that I've talked to that have reviewed this game have 60, 80, 100 hours in it, right? And it's supposedly a huge game. So I'm excited to see how it broadens out, because right now I'm enjoying it, but it feels, to Hoag's point, it feels a little, I don't know, it's not as interesting to me as I'm getting from the people telling me it's super interesting. But again, I'm too early. Is it
more like it's just like Ghost of Tsushima or like From kind of?
Or
neither one?
Neither.
It's Dragon's Dogma. I mean, I'm sorry, it's not a great answer, but I spent the first 2 hours looking for a lock-on button. There isn't one, right? That's you just soft lock to whatever is nearest to you. And if you hold up your shield, it'll block what it hits, right? I mean, it's not locking you into specific kind of frameworks. You're not jumping back like in Ocarina of Time and then doing a big move like that. It's really more like those early Grand Theft Autos, the early late Grand Theft Autos, where you have the physics model showing what's happening with your car and the bullets and things like that. It is physical by its nature. It's a sandbox of what would a sword do if it hit in this way? What would happen to the body? And it gives you that feel. It's very cool, but it doesn't allow you to kind of get into all right, so now I do this, and then he's going to do that, and then I'm going to dodge this way. It avoids that.
It's very free-flowing, just open. Like, you know, like a From game, especially like Sekiro, but even your normal Souls games, they kind of have a rhythm to them, right? You're figuring out patterns and you're playing to that pattern. or like Ghost of Tsushima, it's very technical, right? This is neither of those things, to Hoag's point. It is very just open and free flowing. You can't lock on to anything. As he said, it's a soft lock. You kind of run around, swing your sword. You can jump freely. You can throw stuff freely. It's very open. So
and
you
the big
kinda
thing is you've got like a grab and pin button. So like if you throw a small guy to the ground, you can like jump on him and stab him with your sword. If it's a big guy, you can unbalance them by jumping on him in a certain way and then grabbing onto their skin. I mean, it really is the physics model first and foremost. And it's a lot of fun that way. It feels really cool and different for video games.
It does.
My concerns for Dragon's Dogma, if any, is that I'm not so interested in proceeding to save this world yet. But as playing it, the battle system is really cool. And the magic system is cool. And the way the pawns work now is much more helpful than they used to be. And I think that might make all the difference in terms of how battling feels.
Yeah. It's neat in the sense of because it's so open, it just kind of gives you the sandbox to let whatever happen. Crazy things can happen, right? Like I went up to the top of a tower yesterday. I was looking for something. I got attacked by harpies. And like I jumped at one. I accidentally missed. I fell asleep on the side of the wall. I almost fell off the whole tower. And then my pawn tried to save me and jump up. She went flying over the wall, fell all the way to the ground and died, you know, and it's just chaos, which is kind of funny in a way. One of the funny instances I had that you can do as an example, Dan, if you haven't been paying attention to some of the clips you've seen on social media. So I was on this cliff and there's a ladder that can roll down, but I couldn't reach it. Right. It's just up there. And I was like, how the hell? Like, you can't get to it. So I literally picked up my pawn, who, by the way, I designed after my wife. So which was kind of funny. So I picked her up and I threw her and I picked her up. She's like, what are you doing? And I threw her over the cliff and then she's up there and she just kicked the ladder down to me. And then I climbed up the ladder. You know, and you can just kind of create your own fun in the world, which I think is really neat. So if to Hoag's point, I'm not invested in the story at all. It has nothing to do with that. So I'm hoping that gets better and I'm hoping the world opens up and gets bigger. By all accounts, Elu saying it in the chat right now. Other people I've talked to have said that it does open up and get much grander. So I'm excited to keep playing it. I am enjoying it so far. And I wanted to mention too, because this is Capcom, of course, and obviously this isn't new for them. They made Dragon's Dogma before, but I like seeing these kind of Japanese interpretations of Western RPGs. We've talked a lot about JRPGs on the show. and I like seeing something in the vein of a medieval dragon and knight in armor RPG from a Western studio, because it's just got a different feel to it. From a Japanese studio. I didn't know if I just said Western studio, but you know what I mean. So like, you know, the Elden Rings of the world, the Dragon's Dogma, I think this is pretty cool. It kind of vibes with me a little more, as I've talked about before. I tend to prefer the Western RPG style, so I'm digging it.
It's really interesting because I was playing Dragon's Dogma and I was thinking that the actual dialogue and text and quest mechanisms aren't really very strong. And yet I was seeing the high reviews. I was seeing people really respond to them very well. And that speaks both to a kind of difference in what I'm looking for from a game and what others are, and me trying to not undervalue the aspects of the sandbox that are really cool that I was really enjoying. So I think people are letting games be themselves a little bit more now. And I think that's good. I think some of the problems I have with Rebirth, for instance, as I jokingly said to Alex in those DMs as being a little bit too Sonic Adventure random for me, is being accepted by more gamers and people that maybe wouldn't have done that before. And yes, in Final Fantasy Rebirth, you are going to eventually meet a goblin that's going to talk to you in slang and wear 90s clothes and talk to you in only 90s slang. That's the kind of thing that happens in Final Fantasy VII Rebirth. And I think that's great. And it's causing me to reflect on my own kind of biases and what I want to see out of these games, because I think Dragon's Dogma is good, and I think the first one was good, and I think the first one would probably get better received now based on what I've seen in terms of how Dragon's Dogma 2 is being received, and I think that's overall a good thing. But it doesn't mean it's necessarily a game for me. We'll see how it goes. I have way too much stuff to play right now, and Dragon's Dogma is going to have to hook me at some point in the near future for me to stick with it, and I hope it does, but I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, I think I'm going to try to stick with it as well. So we'll report back. Obviously, we'll see what Travis thinks here in a couple weeks. I'm going to have a lot more time into it. Like I said, I'm excited for it to open up. I see a lot of people joking about me saying I was throwing my wife in the game because I designed my pawn after. So here's an even funnier story. So I'm sitting here playing yesterday or the day before. Wife was doing something. I said, hey, babe, come over. Check this. I said, I made you in the game. And my guy's like big beefcake guy. And if you don't know, in real life, I'm like a foot taller than my wife. My wife's small. And so I show her. I'm like, look, I made you in the game. And it looks like her and everything. And sure enough, right when I called her over to look at the game to see, my pawn says, what do you want me to do, master? And I was like, my wife just gave me this look. And I'm like, oh, for God's sakes, that was terrible timing. So I tried to explain my way out of that one, but we had a good
I made Aslan from Chronicles of Narnia. He rolls with me. He's a big lion man.
Nice. That is one thing that's really cool, right? Both your character and your pawn. You can the creator. You can really go nuts. People have made like all kinds of representations of different characters, and I saw an awesome Geralt yesterday, and obviously what's his name from Dune.
What's his name from Dune?
You know, the Willy Wonka
Paul
kid.
Paul Atreides?
Yeah, that guy. So anyway, you can kind of create things to your heart's content, which
it's really cool. And by the way, as someone that doesn't like a character creator, like I just don't like sliding things around as much as other people do.
No? Man, I spent like an hour.
They have a really cool system for the faces that is very reminiscent of like a Midjourney or one of these AI programs where you kind of pick a face, and then it gives you six alternatives that are kind of like that face, but have certain small changes. And then you pick that and you do it twice in order to kind of zoom in on what you want your character to look like. And it's really good if you just start from like a notion of what you want it to be, or even a picture, if you're looking for Timothée Chalamet to be in there. And I think it works really well. And certainly for someone like me that doesn't like those sliders, it gets much more interesting, good looking characters than some of the other alternatives I've seen.
Yeah.
So I do want to give the game really credit good for some cool stuff.
Yeah, they're really, really strong. Yeah. So Dragon's Dogma 2 selling well, apparently. It's one of the best-selling games on all the platforms. Very highly reviewed, highly regarded. And then comes in the negativity conversation around microtransactions in the game that generally weren't covered extremely well in the review process. I did not review it. I can't speak to what was in the review guide. But essentially, if you haven't seen this debate or conversation, there are microtransactions in the game. Hoke, I haven't even looked at them. I've only read what's in there, but it's stuff that you can like use in the game to help you, do things quicker.
These are what I would call shortcut DLCs.
Yes.
And what's funny about this is that like the reviews were so high when the embargo lifted, I go to sleep that night and I wake up and then my entire timeline is that Dragon's Dogma is getting killed on Steam and showing all these DLCs. And they've got DLCs for like changing your character, changing your pawns, using fast travel and these various things. And my brother, who loves Dragon's Dogma and was very excited about this game, texts me while I'm prepping for a video on Friday morning and says, are we getting Dragon's Dogma? Because I hear all this bad stuff. And I said, it all looked to me like it was shortcut type stuff. And it is. These are all things that you can buy in the game. But they are things that are convenience items that Capcom has put in their DLCs. They've done this before in games like Resident Evil in the past. And while I don't object to their existence, I do think that it can present a bad incentive for the development design in the long term to hold things back if you know you're going to sell them as DLC. So I think you have to evaluate every game that does this kind of thing on a case-by-case basis.
Ubisoft does a lot of this too.
Ubisoft does a lot of shortcutting with like the Assassin's Creed franchise. And you look, I think there was somebody in the chat that was saying they were playing Odyssey, which is one of my favorite games, but they certainly have a pretty high grind time on the level bar that can be improved by giving them a little bit more money. And so you can look at every game on a case-by-case basis and evaluate them for that. What I'd always recommend for people to do with any kind of internet controversy is to take into account that it exists, but then evaluate it for yourself. And I know that's not always an option for a $60 game that you have to invest in, but I can tell you that in my time with Dragon's Dogma, which is limited, it's between 5 and 10 hours at this point, I've not seen any reason to need any of the things that I saw advertised as DLC, and I have had access to purchase those things from the stores in the game already in that time frame alone. So I think it's a mountain out of a molehill. Unfortunately, social media and the internet values engagement over all other things, and so you do get people yelling about things that maybe a little bit early, maybe premature. Premature yelling on the internet. And so I don't think Dragon's Dogma deserves this particular firestorm, but I don't want to just dismiss the conversation that can be had around, yes, you can have an issue with people designing overly grindy things or making fast travel or whatever else we're talking about too inaccessible, because we know that convenience is going to be more valuable to you. You're going to make more money if we make it more inconvenient in the game. This is kind of the conversation about World of Warcraft back in the day, and whether or not they would make you run to turn in quests and things, because if we know you're on a subscription, we can make your game a little bit worse. And I think it's a valuable conversation, but I don't think that the firestorm that hit Dragon's Dogma is entirely earned.
Yeah, I think that's well said, Hoag. I think to your exact point, right? I think the conversation around microtransactions and single player games is a one we need to have and should have, especially to the point you raised of, how is the game designed around them, right? That's what you start to get concerned about. And I know Odyssey, and Dan, correct me if I'm wrong, but we talked about Odyssey a long time ago with its single player. You can double your XP gain, right? With a microtransaction. Yeah, and money. Yeah.
Both of them. Yeah, you can do both. Yeah. I bought them both, just so you know.
I love Odyssey so much. I don't even care, but yeah, so I get that.
Yeah. I think that's it. And I know Capcom has responded a little bit to this, right? Because one of the things that came up was around, like, you have one save file in Dragon's Dogma. And if you want to create a second save file, you have to, from what I understand, someone can correct me if I'm wrong, you can't really just create multiple characters, right? Like, you have one character.
Yeah, it's a server-based game, right? So, like, one of the things that's happening is the pawn that you create is being made available to other characters, other players that are playing online. And they do this kind of without you noticing. So if you go and you sleep at the inn, your pawn returns to you and tells you what he did on his adventure, except for you it was 10 seconds, so you know this stuff is happening in the background. And so it's clear that what they were doing with the saves, your character and your pawns, was keeping a kind of server updated on this information. And then people said, well, what if I want to try again? And if you're going to charge me money for changing my appearance, that's going to be a big concern to me, et cetera, et cetera. And then it gets into a Steam firestorm. And so Capcom said that you're going to be able to restart with like a delete of some kind, right?
Yeah, yeah. So I think, you know, I think there is a conversation around, like I said, microtransactions, single player games. But to your point, you know, I've talked to a lot of people who have played this game. I've talked to people who have reviewed it. And let's not forget that I kind of think the irony in this conversation is that the part of the outrage is that the microtransactions weren't really discussed in the reviews, or that maybe Capcom wasn't very clear about what were going to be in the game. My counterpoint to that is, okay, so the game reviewed extremely well, and the reviewers didn't know about the microtransactions. What does that tell you? It means you don't need them, right? It means that the game is absolutely incredible without the microtransactions, obviously, because that's how it was reviewed.
Well, I think as a consumer, my concern would be, if you can add microtransactions, did you at the same time remove those things that you're now selling for real money from the store, and that the reviewers had a different experience than the consumer on day
agree.
One?
Agree. But I'm talking about the game itself, right? Obviously, I know, but the game is okay without.
But the game is the players, the reviewers were going through and potentially getting those stones that revive people at the store and were changing their appearance and doing all these various things. So my concern, not having played the game, right, I haven't spent the $60 yet, would be that you can put on those microtransactions and then change the background of the game.
I'm not
playing what the reviewers played anyway.
Yeah. You know, I don't think that's what's occurred. That would be a different conversation, obviously.
As far as I can tell, that's not what occurred at all. But I mean, like, that's where you get the concern from a kind of Consumer Reports perspective, right?
Yeah. But then I've talked to other people who currently have 30, 40, 50, some that have reviewed it and said, no, you don't need them at all. So I guess the shortest way to say this, I would say this, is I've seen people, like well-known people like SkillUp even posted yesterday, like, any microtransaction in a single-player game is bad. And I'm like, that's just too broad of a blanket statement. I don't agree with that. I think you can have microtransactions in single-player games. There's nothing wrong with that. I think what Hoag said perfectly aligns, which is you have to consider the game's design, and is the game design kind of forcing you or encouraging you down the microtransaction route, which then can become a negative. But if you know, just blanketly saying a single player game shouldn't have microtransactions, I think is absurd. And to Dan's point, and Dan, you can speak on this, obviously, but at the end of the day, how people spend their money is their own concern. You know, a dollar to me is a different than a dollar to Dan or anyone else in the world, right? And if Dan felt like, hey, I'm enjoying the hell out of Odyssey, and other people may not have an issue with it, but I'm going to speed up my experience because I can afford to do that, and I don't, it's worth it to me personally, then what's to say he shouldn't do that?
And people do that all the time in free-to-play contexts, certainly.
Absolutely.
Right? For whatever reason, the $0 is different. I do that myself, which is if you've given me a lot of joy on your free-to-play game, I will look for something at about the $5 level to buy from you because I think you've earned it from me. And I think people are just resented at the full price because we're still in a transition period from when even microtransactions started to be a thing. But yeah, I think that they can be of value to certain people in certain contexts. And the important thing is to understand that if it is designed around the microtransactions, just to understand that it's not a $60 game, it's really a $100 game for what the value is to, that you'd actually enjoy it at, and to evaluate it properly for yourself from there. But I don't agree with kind of the black and white, all microtransactions are bad, this design is good kind of thing. I think you have to evaluate it on your own. And Dragon's Dogma, so far for me, has not indicated that it is designed around selling you microtransactions at all.
Great.
The biggest problem I have is with something like Odyssey, which I loved, which I bought the stuff for, is it does get that one affected, you know, how the game was built, right? It was a super grindy game.
It was
to level up, and those, and really, I'm not sure how much it helped, but it did. You know, I was actually able to, you know, get to a certain point, you know. But I mean, I hate grinding in any games, though. I mean, I'm just not a big fan of it. So there's a workaround. I can't stand it. Can't stand it. So like, Yakuza's got them, right? You can buy levels, and you can do it, you know, with the last two games anyway. You can buy
level
upgrades. Yeah, Infinite Wealth and Like a Dragon. You can buy what are the other stuff? The jobs, level up jobs. You can get crafting materials. You can do all that stuff. You had to buy the deluxe version for the New Game Plus, which I think is way more egregious than some of this stuff.
I agree. And we talked about that too. Yes.
Yeah, it's garbage. I'm not a huge fan of microtransactions in single player games generally. I don't think they're necessary. I think, you know, as long as everything can be earned, you know, without having to sit there for hours and hours and hours to grind, then you look at games like Fallout. Or not Fallout, but Far Cry, you know, 6 or mm-hmm. 5, where they had, you know, tons of different costumes for you to wear for your character in a first-person mm-hmm. game, which I don't understand anyway. But, they sell them, you know, and if people, they're not going to sell them if people aren't buying them. People are buying them. I'm probably one of them. So it's you know, do what you're going to do. Just don't mess with the core gameplay loop, right? Don't mess with
yes.
you know how. Don't build it to.
Heck, I'd like that as a marketing point, these, right? I would. You see in media, you see firewalls between editorial and advertising. I would love to see a company that goes out as part of their marketing and say our design is completely separate from our commercial, our MTX yeah. team or what have you. Now that's not going to happen because they're intimately related to how games are made today. But I think you could market a game and say, look, we're going to have MTX. It's going to be single player, whatever. But the game designers are not even going to be told what it is we're selling or how we're going to monetize it. And that might be a better option for some company out there to go forward with games. But I'm probably the wrong person to ask on these things because most of the stuff doesn't bother me that much. And I'm of the opinion that people should be allowed to exchange their money for their time if that's how they value the exchange. I just don't want it to get to a point where the game developer is so incentivized to go get that money that they make their game unfun at the baseline level.
Agreed. Exactly yeah. right. I'm the same way. Yeah.
I mean, we'll see. I mean, I saw the list of stuff, but I haven't played the game, so I don't know how easy it is to get some of that stuff that they were talking about. I understand, you know, kind of, you know, the server-based stuff where you gotta buy an extra save, whatever. I think that's probably garbage, but you know, it's I mean, you're paying full price for a game, and they're going up. I mean, you know, if you think $80 games aren't going to be a thing here in a few years, you're out of your mind. So, I mean, but if you're going to continue to put these kind of things, you know, in the game, and you build around that, I mean, I just don't, like, why even put them in there in the first place, I guess, is what I'm asking. Why would they have to be there if the game is built correctly, if it's built to get these items? Like, I think I saw a key that you could get out of jail with or something like that. If that's, you know, so
you can buy that in the game too.
You can buy that.
You can buy all of it in the game.
Right.
Yeah, okay. You can buy all of it in the game.
Then why even sell it? Because
people will pay for it.
We just talked about, Dan, that we have a different capacity for grinding, right? I like a good grind. Like, I feel good about a power curve that I have to earn with time. You like it less. If you're a wealthy person that likes it less, they might as well go and take that money from you, says the studio, right? But I still want that game made that way for me. I still like that grind. In fact, one of the reasons I play free-to-play games is I like to go and try to earn those things as much as I can. I'm a weird person. I'm wired differently. My therapist will tell you that.
Yeah, I don't know. The other thing I consider, maybe it has no relevance here. You can tell me if it doesn't. But we've talked before around the difference in experiences you can get in a $70 game, right? You can get a $70 game that's 10 hours long. You can get a $70 game that's 150 hours long. And I look at something like Dragon's Dogma, which obviously took years to make and it gives this grandiose experience. And maybe it's wrong, but the way I look at it is, if I'm going to get 50 plus to 100 plus hours out of this game that I spent $70 on, that's an absolute steal of a bargain. Yeah. And it just doesn't bother me. Maybe I'm to Hoag's point, maybe I'm weird too. It just doesn't bother me.
Different people are going to have different capacities for this, right? This is economics 101. This is that the price is set at what is a market clearing price. We can sell what we make, but it doesn't mean that it's maximized all the dollars that somebody is getting out of value from that product. And so you can think it's dirty capitalism or greedy corporations or whatever, but some of those companies are going to be saying, okay, well, actually, this game is going to be worth $85 to Ains because of these reasons, and we can sell him a stone or a key or whatever, and he'll go for it because his time is worth it, and he's enjoying this product enough that he's willing to pay that. And so we set the market to do those kinds of things. It's like airplane tickets or hotel rooms that are based on what kind of day you're staying there, and using algorithms and mathematics to figure out how much they can bleed you for. And you don't have to love that process, right? We're on the consumer side of this question. But I'm also not going to throw the company under the bus for doing these various things if people want them. And I think, honestly, the biggest issue for me with this is that the stuff is so available in the game. It almost seems like a lie that Capcom goes out there and says, look at this cool thing that you should spend $2 for at the front end, right? Because I'm often looking at the DLC lists when I first get a game and seeing what I want to get and not looking at it later. And if I bought those jail keys for $3 or whatever they're selling for, and then saw them available for like 2 gold or some small amount in the first town in Dragon's Dogma, which is what happens, I might resent that a little bit. That's a bigger problem for me, the design, and potentially the looking at it and saying, well, that's actually not worth even what you're charging, because I'm not familiar with what these things are in the game. So there's a certain element of trust there.
Yeah, also a fair point. Yeah, some good comments in the chat here on both. You know, Katendra says, if it's pay to win, I have a problem with it. If it's pay to enhance, I have no problem. I need to have a choice without the microtransactions.
Is there a pay to win concept in a single player game?
Pay to win, I think you'd have to broaden that definition. You know, not really. Maybe if you could make a case, maybe if there's like a boss in the game that, you know, you can power yourself up easily by paying more, something like that. But yeah, I don't really know. Nixie says the game doesn't incentivize it. It's there for convenience. And I think that's kind of what we're saying, right? If things there for convenience that don't negatively impact the design of the game, I'm all for. It doesn't bother me at all. If the game's design is more broken without spending additional money, then I would probably have a problem with it. I think that's as simply as I can put it, but that's really what you already said, Hoag. So,
yeah, no, I think you can imagine it as two universes, right? The universe where the game gets designed, and then the money guys come by and say, well, what aspects of this could we shorten for people and potentially make better for people who don't have enough time to play an open world game like this? And then the alternative is, all right, we're going to design this thing to make this as painful as possible so that you have to spend this money to get past this stuff.
Yeah.
And I like the first one and I don't like the second one.
Agree. And I think we would all agree on that, right? Like, I don't think anyone is saying, yeah, make the game harder so I have to pay extra. Like, I think we're all in agreement that's not the case.
Right.
Let's get a couple of these super chats caught up.
Sure.
Yeah, Jerry Morton's back. Not only me and my father's birthday. Okay, we were right. Yeah, birthday. But also Allison Hannigan. Huge crush on Allison Hannigan, by the way. And her daughters.
Who
That's
is that?
Willow? That's Willow.
It's Willow. It's also, she was at, Bandcamp, man. She played the flute.
She was at Bandcamp. That's true.
Okay, got it.
Willow to me.
Now I get it.
Looking forward to April and all four of you back. Yeah,
me too. We were joking yesterday in our Bitcast DM that like it's been a year. There hasn't been a lot of Bitcast with all four of us so far. That is obviously not by design, just a lot going on. So
my wife
can tell we're trying to get here as often as possible. It's just been that kind of year.
It's been that kind of year.
Thank you, Jeremy.
Yeah, Jeremy, very generous today. Thank you so much again. Nick. Happy birthday. And happy birthday, Nick. Yes.
I don't, is this a Cronin? Is that what this is? Remember what this is. Cronin. Yep. Cronin O'Brien. Never mind. Yes, microtransactions are not needed. Here's $2.
Thank you, Nick. You know, Bitcast does not require your additional funding. You know what I mean? It's a free to watch show. But we do appreciate, you know,
it helps.
Actually, we're gonna ask everybody to pay $5 to get Travis back.
if you want Hoag's outro, it's an extra $4. Yes.
Actually, it's $5 to keep Travis off.
Oh, okay. You're gonna see a line of super chats just.
Great, Nick. Thank you very much. We got Papa Hoag sighting in the house.
Papa Hoag's here.
My dad likes to come in strong.
Good to see you, Dad. A member for 22 months. Microtransactions in a one-player experience is fraud. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, buddy. I think you should sell your game as incomplete or demo. Remember Ultima's disc after gold? See, this guy knows what he's talking about.
They had to fix games after release back in the day before we had the mighty internet.
He went back to
fraud, Dad. That does require deceit on their part. Certainly, the DLC on a Steam game is you can see it in a list next to the game that you're about to purchase. So I have a problem suggesting that it's deceitful at the point of sales. You might say it's deceitful in design, but you're probably not going to play Dragon's Dogma anyway. But if you were, I think you'd find it would be a good experience without purchasing the DLC.
Yeah, and like I said, everyone I've talked to, and anyone in the chat can correct me, but everyone I've talked to who's playing this game and really loving it, even the guys at SG, the people I talked to online, no one has said that they felt like they needed to spend extra money on the game. Thank you, Papa O. Good to see you. All right. Well, gentlemen, I think that wraps us up on that conversation anyway. So, Final Fantasy... It's getting some updates, and I know that Hoag, you're typically our Final Fantasy guru here on the show. So
not too much 14, but yeah.
I was just going to say, I don't think you really play 14, but 16, which you really love. The expansion is coming, and actually coming quite soon. The first expansion coming quite soon.
We got the first expansion in December. Your site reviewed it, Ains.
I'm up to date on all things, as you can tell. I've been out of the loop for a while. Sorry.
No, I'm just joking with you. Alex reviewed it, so he updated me. Yes,
he did. Yes, he did. I forgot. Thank you. Rising Tide comes out April 18th, which, as we're talking today, is only 3 weeks from now. So, you looking forward to this one?
Absolutely. No relation to Against the Tide. So, if you played Final Fantasy 16, you know that one of the icons that's mentioned in the lore is Leviathan the Lost, I believe. And Leviathan is a summon in prior Final Fantasy games, and water really wasn't represented in Final Fantasy 16. So if you go and you watch this trailer, you will see that the icon Leviathan is back for reasons that are unknown, because we don't know the story of the expansion yet, but it's going to be cool. I love Final Fantasy 16. I've had this conversation with folks online. I actually find Final Fantasy 16's plot to be more engaging than Rebirth's, even though I think Rebirth is doing a lot of cool stuff.
I didn't see it. So is it like a post-game DLC, or is it a, like, you know, I can do it whenever I want to DLC?
I actually don't know where they're going to put it. It's going to be before the end of the game. If you've played Final Fantasy 16, you know that. But I don't know how it's going to be structured within like their menu system or anything else.
All right. Good to know. I'll buy it.
Sorry that I'm smiling and smirking and laughing over here, but Papa Hoag has another super chat and
coming in here.
Hot. I know, it's making me laugh.
Dad rolls.
Now we know where Hoag gets it. I like it. Hilarious. Yeah, well, we're going to go ahead and get to it right now because it's too funny not to. So, Papa Hoag, round two.
With the $9.99 super. So, son, are you okay with a hotel room selling for a room without pillows? This is a slippery slope. Don't let them get away with this. Don't buy fraudulently advertised complete games.
I'm telling you, I love you, man, but the game does not have anything you can get from DLC that's not already in it. They're just selling you stuff early in case you need it for convenience. But every item that they're selling in DLC, as far as I know, I don't want to stand on this for certainty because I haven't played all of Dragon's Dogma 2 yet, is in the game. Certainly everything that I've seen on DLC, I have seen in stores so far. So it's not quite the same as room without pillows. It's more like, is it okay for them to have a mini bar?
Yeah, that's probably a better comparison. But that, oh, man, I saw that pop up while you guys were talking and I couldn't help but laugh.
Here's the thing with all these little microtransactions, not to get back on it, but I mean, how about just sell the game that, you know, works out of the box? I'm not so sure the last time I saw that was.
But it
just
does.
You want to talk about performance without any hiccups, Dragon's Dogma? I would much prefer a locked 30. We can talk about performance all day. But as for the DLC question, I don't have an issue with how it was sold.
Yeah, I'm never going to play. Yeah. The hell do I care?
Why not?
But no, it's just not my type of game.
Not your type of game. Fair enough. Yeah. Papa Hoag, love you. Thank you very much.
He sees Travis isn't here and he has to keep me in my place.
I need a versus between the super chat and Hoag. Yeah. That's what I need. Rob coming in with $10 super chat.
$10 super chat, Rob. I just wanted to give Nixes a shout out for developing an excellent PC build of Horizon Forbidden West. Nice. Love or hate the game itself. Nixes does a really good well with their PC ports. They deserve recognition. You know, I saw some of that stuff.
It's very true.
Ultra wide.
Did that port work out well?
Holy crap.
Supposed to run really great. Yeah, and Nixis, to Rob's point, has been a great company for PlayStation. They're doing some fantastic work on their PC builds. Yeah, good stuff.
What is, there's ultra wide and there's like what, like an ultra wide?
There's super ultra wide. Yeah,
that's new to me. Didn't know that until last week.
Yeah, so ultra wide, I'm actually, when I do Bitcast, I'm on my ultra wide right now. So this is 34 inch. So it's 3440 by 1440, right? So 1440p, but it's 34 inches wide. And then super ultra wide, I believe Rob may correct me or someone, but I think it's 52.
That's disgusting.
It's like, yeah,
you're
it's
like even, wrapped even around wide. You.
Basically, yeah. I'm actually not a fan of super ultra wide. I think it's too much.
I have a single standard monitor.
Yeah. Well, so funny enough, I have a 34 inch ultra wide right next to it where I have the YouTube up right now. Is my 32 inch 260 hertz monitor that I play like Halo and stuff on at high frame rates.
I got a Dell.
my monitor is also a Dell.
They are right, Dell Burrows.
Oh boy. Yeah, I'm not actually a fan of super ultra wide. It's great for working, like. If you do spreadsheets or design or stuff, that's usually gaming. I think it's actually a little too broad. Personally, that's just me. I do love ultra wide. I'm playing Dragon's Dogma 2 in ultra wide, and it's great. You know, Elden Ring has a mod where you can play in ultra wide. So ultra wide games in general are pretty good. They're a lot of fun. But yeah. Anyway, Nixis, yeah, shout out to them. I'm also, you know, Ghost of Tsushima. I got like 30, 40 hours in on the PS5. I never went back to it. You know, they've obviously got the PC port coming of the definitive edition or whatever. I'm actually debating playing it on PC because I'm sure it's going to be spectacular.
I love the Japanese with the old Kurosawa film footage on Tsushima.
Yeah, there's some really cool things in that game. I wasn't as high on it as others that really, really adore it, but
my game of the year. Yeah,
I did think it was very well done. So, but anyway, yeah, good call out, Rob. Thank you for the super chat.
I'm always glad to hear it when the ports work out well, because there were a couple at the early stages when PlayStation started doing that where people were complaining about the ports coming over.
That's literally why they bought Nixis. Yeah. That's why they acquired Nixis. Yeah, and Spider-Man's supposed to be fantastic as well. So it's good stuff.
I mean, it's still Spider-Man 2, right? But yeah.
I meant Spider-Man 1, because 2's not there yet, but yeah.
Well, Spider-Man 1's great. Go play Spider-Man 1, folks. And that's when the series ends.
On Ultra Wide.
Play Miles Morales, too.
Oh, man. All right, I got all off track with Ultra Wide and Super Ultra Wide and
yes, you were asking about Final Fantasy updates. We were talking about Final Fantasy 16. I assumed you were going to segue into 14.
Yeah, so 14's expansion, Dawn Trail, which is, as I understand it, for the people that play 14, you know, has been waited on quite a while. This is a long time coming. Early access June 28th, and then full launch July 2nd. So I'm sure this is going to be a big release too. Final Fantasy 14 continues to thrive, I guess, in the MMO space, which is cool to see.
Well, I think there's a little bit of a reduction in audience after Endwalker, which isn't a surprise. But I hope it continues on because Final Fantasy 14 is great. I just never get far enough in it to really get into the places where people think it's so awesome. I only ever play a Realm Reborn and then wind up mining rocks the whole time. So again,
I hear the early part of it is very grindy.
It is ridiculously grindy.
You know what would help with that? Microtransactions. Yeah.
Can I get some, it's funny. I go to one of those games because I want to see the story, and it's very, it's a high volume story, but it's really boring for like a long stretch. And then people say it really gets good at hour 150 or whatever. And I've just never gotten there.
Oh, man.
Yeah, that's always a funny conversation as well. You know, how much you have to play till a game gets good.
Well, it's a fun world. The job system is really cool. There's a lot of fun things to do. But the overall plot apparently doesn't kick in until you're done with the base game.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, I always wanted to get into it too. But to your point, it's like, the last thing I need is another kind of live service grindy game. I just don't have time for it.
Yep. I'm already a pirate in the Indian Ocean. That is my current live service.
Glad to hear you're still enjoying that, though. That game kind of came out, and at least for me on my timeline, I don't see anyone talking about it. I don't know what the player base
looks
like.
People are having fun hating on it. I think Travis and I said last week that we were the only podcast talking about it because Travis and I like the game. But yeah, it's interesting. I don't know that it's going to last super long, except for Ubisoft's history of keeping these games alive. But I love it. I have a lot of fun with it. It is both relaxing and intense in equal measure because you get a lot of sailing around islands and listening to sea shanties. And then you get a lot of kind of cannonball fights in a storm. And I like both of those things. So I hope Skull and Bones is a massive success, but I doubt that it will last too terribly long. And as we've said before on this show, if I like a live service game, run away, because it's not going to last very long at all.
I think that's one of the things I appreciate, though, is like, you know, you get these kind of narratives that develop on social media and spread pretty quickly, right? Like the microtransaction one we just talked about. But I think we do a good job here, again, just crediting ourselves a bit, of just kind of ignoring the noise and just talking about the games as they actually are. I think in that vein too, what was shown this week, if you didn't see, was season one launching on Tuesday, I believe, or later this week, of Suicide Squad, which is Joker being added as a playable character, you know, new weapons, new Elseworld, all that stuff. It's kind of their big first update and a whole bunch of bug fixes. And, you know, I really enjoyed the hell out of that game. I've put quite a bit of time into Suicide Squad. Looking forward to going back to it for episode one. And I think it's really cool. I don't think they're getting enough credit, at least again, anecdotally, that the character additions are not paid. They're free. Like Joker's being added to the game, and you can just, you know, whether you've bought season pass or anything else, you can just use him as a new character, which I think is really cool.
Yeah, I think their model is good. And I actually reminded myself how much I enjoyed Suicide Squad when I was really upset at Rebirth this past week. I was just frustrated at it not doing anything. And I was looking for something else to play. And Starfield rejected me because it needed an update. And Diablo rejected me because it needed an update. And so I said, okay, fine, Suicide Squad. And then I put on Suicide Squad and I just had a grand old time. So I think that's a fun game that has unfortunately gotten hit by a lot of various things happening to it all at once. The IGN stuff happened, of course. The Sweet Baby stuff happened. All these kind of social media movements hit this poor game all at once. And I think as a game, it's actually an enjoyable game. You separate it off from some of the other things that are happening in the world and in the discourse, as it were. I think mostly I can recommend it. You're going to have a good time playing the game Suicide Squad.
Yeah, it's odd, and we're going on a bit of a tangent here, but both my stepson and my son, so we're talking about late teen and early 20s, both of them, when I talked about Suicide Squad, told me, oh, I heard that game's terrible.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just that narrative just kind of, and they won't play it. You know what I mean? They don't even give it a look. And that narrative kind of just the way that spreads now socially, especially in kind of the Discord spaces, the younger, you know, where kind of that age group navigates it's pretty crazy. It's kind of a shame because I feel like a lot of games that people would enjoy will be missed. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. So. That's why I like doing this show. So yeah, I think Suicide Squad is a good game. It is certainly a very dynamic action game that puts my hand to the test. So I recommend it to folks. You have to put some of the stuff out of your mind, like it's not an Arkham game. Even though it has a lot of Arkham touch points, it doesn't give you that same single player experience. And a lot of the mission design is kind of pre-end game. I mean, you can tell that it's all baked around being an end game kind of activity while you're playing through the campaign.
Yes,
so once you understand that, once you understand that the campaign is a vehicle to end game, like a Diablo type game, I think you can be more gracious towards what it is that you're actually playing because they have a lot of good ideas there.
Yes. Agree. And it obviously has faults. I'm not saying this game's a 9 or 10 or anything like that. It has faults. But yeah, it's very enjoyable just to play. By the way, laughing about Final Fantasy 14, GT James says it has a microtransaction to skip to level 50 and a second microtransaction to skip the opening story if you want to.
And it charges more if you need more character slots. I mean, it's an MMO.
that's pretty typical. Yeah, no doubt. speaking of Diablo, they had a campfire chat this week.
They had a campfire freaking discourse. That was like a state of the union.
Yeah. From again, all the people I've talked to, I'm trying to catch up with everything. Obviously, I haven't been around, but with other people I talked to and some pretty hardcore people, I know Katie's in the chat who loves Diablo 4. Hoagie, you love Diablo 4. And I did when I was playing it for a review and at launch, but hearing a ton of positive feedback from this campfire chat. A lot of good changes they're working on from what I've read.
Yeah, so let me talk about this a little bit. I'm going to talk about it from a slightly different perspective than some. I think there are a lot of people that are excited about this, my brother included, and I want to give the background for the conversations I've had with my brother on Diablo 4. So he dropped off of it like a lot of people did. I stuck with it, and one of the things I've said in this space and to him has been how much I like the build crafting in Diablo 4. And his response was always that Diablo 4 barely has build crafting. It's nothing like he would mention Path of Exile. Currently, he mentions Last Epoch, I think is the game. Epoch, E-P-O-C-H, as a game that he's playing.
Sorry to interrupt you, Hoke. I'm literally playing that game, and I forgot to mention it. This is where my mind is right now. So I'll come back to that after your comments on Diablo.
Oh, sure. And so he would say, no, it's got a lot more personality. You can adjust the skills themselves and these various things. And I would say, I don't actually like that complexity. I like to have a more directed approach with a couple of options that I can take in these various aspects. And he said, well, that's, you're lame and a loser. And he's a brother, you know how it is. And I would say, well, this is the game that I want to play. And I love Diablo 4 and it's really clicked with me. And I put it high up in my rankings and people have heard me talk about it so much. And I think what this change is doing is bringing it closer to Path of Exile and the Last Epochs of the world. And I think that's going to be good for a lot of people. I think Diablo 4 clearly lost an audience of people like my brother and the folks I see on social media. That wasn't me. I'm not enough to keep one of these games up on my own. The people like me. And so I think that's overall good for the game. But I suspect this is going to move away from what I like. And I'm going to wind up in the Dan Rodriguez Cyberpunk 2.0 bucket.
Okay. All right. Wow. Yeah, so I haven't looked at the full list of changes. I know there's a lot. Katie, who I just mentioned, who I know plays the hell out of Diablo 4, she's in our Discord, and we talk Diablo 4 quite a bit there. She says she's super excited. So, yeah, I guess there's just, as always, right, you can't please everyone with the changes.
Hey, I hope it's awesome. I'm going to give it a try. It sounded good. It sounds well thought of. It just sounds more complex than I actually want out of this experience for me.
Gotcha. Fair enough. Yeah, so we'll see how that turns out. Obviously, we'll talk more about that in the future. And it's funny you mentioned Last Epoch because I forgot to put a note that I am playing that. I actually bought that because I could play it on my Steam Deck, with all the traveling I was having to do. So I've only got about the same as Dragon's Dogma, about 4 or 5 hours in the last epoch. I've heard great things from the people who love ARPGs, which is why it was recommended to me, because I do. I am enjoying it so far. Definitely, you know, different type of systems. It's kind of got the old school, just pick your class at the start and then they can specialize later on. Combat feels good. The loot feels solid so far. But I am very early in it, but I have heard very positive things about it. It does, from what I can tell, you kind of get into the more of upgrading and crafting and customizing your weapons, right? And your skill, the skill tree looks to be more of a, as you expand out, looks to be more of a passive type of thing that sits in between, say, a Diablo and a Path of Exile, where it's got a little more customization there. So, we'll see. I'll talk more about that in the future as well, but I've enjoyed that so far. Playing it on my ultra wide now at home. So, another good experience for that.
And I'll react to it when it comes out. I thought it was cool that they've gone over and thought about all these things. I like that team. I like the fireside chat format that they do. Campfire chat, I guess. Fireside chat is a president type thing. I have my concerns because it seems so massive a change, and I liked Diablo 4 the way it was. But certainly online, the impression I was always getting was I was the only one. Every time I'd mention how much I like Diablo 4, people would yell at me. That's just online, of course, but we'll see how it goes.
Okay, fair enough. So I actually put up a poll about microtransaction and single player games on the Season Gaming side of the house, but YouTube is apparently having issues. The poll's not working, so not going to worry about that. So speaking of RPGs, we talked a lot about Baldur's Gate 3 here, which obviously Game of the Year, and you know, Dan has put like, I don't know, dozen or so hours into that game. But interesting to hear, it sold, I think it was just reported yesterday actually, that they sold 15 million copies they've passed now of Baldur's Gate 3, which is awesome to see. So huge success for Larian and Wizards of the Coast. However, Larian Studios has come out because they were asked in some form about, are they making a next Baldur's Gate or what have you, you know, the next in the line of that games, and they said no. In fact, they're going to leave D&D behind the license and work on their own thing again, like they had, you know, obviously done in the past. So kind of interesting, you know, have this level of success. Obviously, I know we've talked about Pillars of Eternity here on this show and kind of the success they saw with those games. Obviously, Baldur's Gate 3 kind of blew the doors open, right, in terms of popularity. But, you know, you have that level of success, and now they're saying, you know, we're going to kind of stick to our guns here and go back to something we prefer to do.
Yes, I think you mean the Divinity games.
Divinity. Yeah. Sorry, not Pillars of Eternity. Yes, thank you.
yes, it doesn't surprise me as much as some people were surprised by this particular news. It always seemed like this was an odd thing for them to do—a licensed game—and they were going to try to make a splash with it using this historical license of Baldur's Gate, Forgotten Realms, Dungeons and Dragons overall. You've heard Travis and I say that Baldur's Gate 3 is fantastic, but I do think that the Dungeons and Dragons actually holds them back from some of the originality they were bringing to the original Sin series and Divinity overall. And so I think they've made their splash, right? Winning the Game of the Year awards, all the attention they got from Baldur's Gate 3. And now that they've made their splash, they still get to be the creators of Baldur's Gate 3 when they try to sell you Divinity Original Sin 3. So I think that is a good business model for them. It doesn't surprise me at all, because you have to pay a fortune to licensors that have this intellectual property, and they didn't even really need it. Right, they did to get the attention, but in terms of making the game, they didn't need Dungeons and Dragons to make a great game like that. Original Sin 2 is almost as good as Baldur's Gate 3. They've obviously matured and gotten even better at making these games over the course of that time. But I'm more looking forward to a return to the Divinity universe than I would be for Baldur's Gate 4 or DLC for Baldur's Gate 3.
Yeah. I don't think you're alone, right? I don't think that's a rare opinion. I think that the people who are familiar with Divinity, Elu, I know in the chat is singing your praises, Hoag, as you say that, because you know, he's mentioned that as well, and so has Travis, so have you, that Divinity games are absolutely incredible, and it's not that Baldur's Gate 3 is a bad game. It's an excellent game. But being constrained by the D&D license does come with certain things that are expected of that game, whereas, you know, maybe Larian just says, hey, we can just have complete freedom, to your point, and now they can say, from the makers of Baldur's Gate 3, right, which comes with its own sort of clout at this point.
Yeah, I mean, they're doing amazing over there. I mean, they seem to have figured out the system a little bit, you know, trying to, you know, as far as like, you know, they have studios kind of like all over the world. And I saw an article or that Sven guy that talked about, you know, hey, we got a problem with this.
That Sven guy. I love that it.
Sven guy. You know, I don't know his last name. But anyway, he they'll be working on something, say, you know, over in Europe. And then when they're finished, say somebody over here in Canada or something is, you know, coming into work, that problem goes directly over there with all kinds of communication. They seem to have their stuff together, and they seem to be, you know, just kind of plotting their own path. And it's just works, you know. I mean, I'm fine with them doing whatever the hell they want. It's going to be awesome, probably.
Well, I feel like I'm the guy with that band T-shirt that says I knew them before they were big, right? Like, I love Larian. I love, like, Dragon Commander. Sure. I like some of their weirder stuff, even kind of semi-attached to the Divinity series that they were doing before this. I am so thrilled for them that they succeeded so much on Baldur's Gate 3, and I am looking forward to what they make next because they're an amazing studio, and they don't need to take 20% off the top or whatever their royalty rate is and send it to Wizards of the Coast or send it to Disney or anybody else. They can make their own stuff because they're really, really good at making stuff.
Yeah, and I believe I could be making this up. I don't think I am. I believe that the question of acquisition came up at some point with Larian, and they pretty much said, hey, we're happy being independent. Like,
yeah, no, as I've always said, it takes two to tango, right? Like, you don't want to get sold. You're not getting sold when you own your company. And they seem happy, right? Everybody that you see related to that company, talking about their hours, talking about the way the company culture works, that's what you want your entity to look like when it's fully functional and making lots of money. So we don't know what's happening on the inside, but everything from an outward appearance would suggest they're fine being independent. And if you're independent and you're making it, you want to stay independent. There's no reason to have a parent company if you're making it work.
Agreed. So it's, I mean, we've talked a lot around layoffs and some of the struggles with the industry right now in companies. So, you know, this type of story is also great to see, right?
That's Sven guy apparently had quite the speech at GDC about layoffs, right?
Sven Venke. Yeah. Solitech said, or Soiltech said in Hoax Chat, Sven Venke. Sven guy. Shush says, which I like this comment, would love to see a sci-fi project from Larian.
I'll take it.
Well, and you know, Divinity is at least a little bit sci-fi. It's a weird amalgam of universes that they've built there. So yeah, I think they could make a great sci-fi game. There was an RPG game I used to play way back in the day to really age myself that I loved called Buck Rogers in the 21st Century.
Oh, I remember it. Hell yeah.
Was a Genesis game that really brought into my experience kind of tactical turn-based RPG games. And I don't know that I've seen anything kind of tackle a sci-fi environment like that, right? Like, that's not Mass Effect. That's completely different. It's like Dungeons and Dragons, but in space. You'd go and you'd board other ships, and they would be little dungeons, and you would go and fight with blasters and things like that.
It was a cool game, dude.
They would make a great game in sci-fi.
It was published by EA, I believe, wasn't it? What?
EA had a bunch of weird publishing relationships in the Genesis days. They had a game that I liked called, like, Rings of Power. Not related to the Amazon series. And they had a game called, I can't even remember. They had a bunch of games that they were publishing that were in that RPG van that I don't think they made themselves, but yeah.
No, so I actually had them up at one point, so I'll pull it over in a second, but I was collecting some of the Genesis EA games because they kind of dove into the Western RPG space back then. So they had Might and Magic, they had King's Bounty, which I adored.
Oh, King's Bounty, I love.
Yeah, fantastic. I still literally have my original copy on the shelf in mint condition. They did Star Control or Starflight, one of those. I can't remember now.
Star Control would have been Accolade.
Excuse me. What am I thinking of? I'll pull it over in a second. But anyway, great era of games there. Buck Rogers was one of those, so pretty cool.
I don't even remember a game. I remember a TV show, and that was about it. There was a TV show, right? I'm not like...
No. I mean, absolutely.
Buck Rogers was like a serial movie character. Like, right?
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, that little robot, you know, like, beady, 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 beady. You know,
that one. Yeah, that description was...
Robot again?
Yeah. Beady, 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 beady. Yeah, that was him. I can't remember what his name was, though.
I don't know.
I get Buck Rogers and the black hole mixed up all the time. I don't know why. Probably because I'm old.
Probably because there's a little robot in the black hole.
Yeah, that's true.
Yep. And Lost in Space, too, right? Isn't there a robot in Lost in Space?
Well, Lost in Space has the Danger Will Robinson robot,
right? Okay, yeah, okay. All right, yeah. All right. Yeah, we're all over the place today. Oh, yeah, the old cast. You're not lying, Gamefire.
Hey, I brought up Buck Rogers. It's on me this time.
Yeah.
But yeah, I to everyone's point, going back to Larian real quick, I think it's very clear that whatever they do, they're in good shape to do it. I'm sure it'll be a success. They've got, to Dan's point, they've kind of got these systems in play that they've evolved, right? And kind of not perfected, but continue to refine in their games, and very excited to see what they do next. In fact, I need to get back to Baldur's Gate 3 again. I've got that like special physical edition that Larian is selling coming, which is cool. So
nice. Is that kind of right. Statue, Ains?
I did not get the crate because their collector's edition was like 400, and I'm not like diehard Baldur's Gate, so I'm staying away from some of those. But they sold a normal physical copy directly from them that has like game map and cards and all this stuff, and kind of like an old school physical copy, you know what I mean? So I picked that up.
It makes me sad that those are old school things, because that's what I used to love about getting video games, is
me too.
Opening the map and looking at the little stuff. But hey.
Me too. To stay on old cast for 1 second, I recently picked up the Might and Magic game I was talking about, and I found a mint copy with the hint book, which is like a 150-page book, you know, that came with the game. Nice. And it's like you miss those sort of things, you know. Anyway, I think from a topic standpoint, that's going to wrap us up today. We're going to be a little shorter on the clock today, probably because Travis
is
isn't here, you know, and he's not rambling.
The show, Ains. This is the right time.
Yeah,
we can both take credit, or Travis can either take credit or we can blame him for a shorter show. But to Travis's point, he did want to mention, or wanted me to mention, that he has previews of South Park, the new South Park game, Snow Day, as well as a game called Outpost Infinity Siege, both going live tomorrow on IGN. So you'll see him posting about those. If you're interested in those games, make sure to check those out. And then from my perspective, I know Hoag mentioned it last week, but real quick, I play for Extra Life. I think a lot of people who watch know that. They are doing a big Kansas City United thing for all the children's hospitals here in April. I've been invited to that because I've been playing for them for like 7 years now, raised a bunch of money. They're doing like a special thing, which Hoag showed last week, where if you raise a bunch of money between now and I think like mid-April, you get like free ticket and a jersey and all this stuff to go kind of support your children's hospital. So I'll be working on that. Kind of stay tuned to my Twitter about when I'm streaming, but any support for Extra Life in that sense would be awesome. They do just fantastic work over there for the kids around here that are, you know, really, really suffering some tough times, a lot of those kids. So anything we can do is awesome. And then lastly, kind of counter to what I said, but Nathan Drake statue, this big Prime One statue. So if you're interested in those things that I look at, I mentioned it like weeks ago because of everything going on. I haven't gotten to it. It's been sitting in the box. I'm going to be doing that this week too. So you can check that out. Nice. Hoag, go ahead and call your stuff out. I'm going to grab something real quick while you're talking.
Sure. Well, along the same lines as Ains' work for Extra Life, I did want to thank everybody who voted or participated in helping the vote for the American Stroke Association Stroke Awards that we talked about last week and a couple of weeks ago. That voting is now concluded, and the association is going to say who won the Voters' Choice Award on May 1st, which, if I'm involved with, will probably be appearing on my channel, and if not, it won't be appearing on my channel, I don't think, but we'll see exactly what they're going to do with that. I did want to thank everybody, though, for supporting that. And I also wanted to thank everybody for coming to the channel to see me talk through a lawsuit for 3.5 hours a couple days ago. So we did a big virtual legality on the Department of Justice's lawsuit against Apple as a monopolist of the smartphone industry, which was a surprise to me. And if you're interested in any of that story, I go over the media's coverage of it, the background, the nature of the Sherman Antitrust Act and monopoly laws in America, as well as the lawsuit in its entirety. All 88 pages of it on the Hoag Law YouTube channel, Virtual Legality. You can check it out. I think I did a good job with it, but it certainly took a lot out of me. I was tired the rest of the day that day. 3.5 Jeez. Hours solo is a long time.
Oh my gosh.
No doubt. No doubt. That's a long one. Yeah, I need to watch that because obviously I don't know the details of the lawsuit, which is what you covered. But when you just say Apple monopoly on the smartphone industry, I get confused because they're not even the majority seller of the smartphone. So I need to understand what the actual details are, which is probably what you did. So
I did. I went through all of it. Yeah. And I will tell you, As a spoiler alert, I do look at the lawsuit in its entirety, and I think it was written along the lines of the Epic lawsuit for a monopoly in the iOS ecosystem, a monopoly of iOS access. And they changed their mind at some point, probably when Epic was losing everywhere, and then said it was a monopoly in the smartphone industry, and then don't really defend that particular position very strongly in the document itself, which may or may not be a death knell for the overall lawsuit. As I also say in that video, you cannot just hand wave away a Department of Justice antitrust lawsuit in the same way that you can look at something like the Epic lawsuit and say, well, I think Epic doesn't have much of a case here. Department of Justice does not have a terribly strong case, and they certainly didn't present it very well in the complaint document itself for a monopoly of smartphones. But it's probably going to survive enough to make Apple's life a living nightmare for some time to come. So please do check out that video, folks. I think there's a lot we talk about. We talk through a lot of comments and questions as well during the entirety of that video. And so don't be scared away by the running time. It's a great companion for your daily jog or to fall asleep to if you just like legal documents read to you. So check it out on the channel.
Very cool. The reason I got it for a second is I think I mentioned on social media, but I'm also checking this thing out, which I need a few more weeks to check out, but it's called the Polymega Modular Retro System. It is very interesting. So what it basically does is it can take your actual old physical games in various ways, and it stores them on there legally, right? So you're not just emulating, even though it is an emulator, but it's all through legal software. And then it digitizes your entire collection. And then it also has like a full UI and menu system where it gives you history of the game, how it was developed. It's kind of this interesting, weird thing. It's also modular. So basically, like, you have this core system where it takes like PlayStation 1 discs and all that, but then you can slot this module in and out and put Genesis or Super Nintendo or Nintendo, or all these old systems in there. So I'm checking it out. It's expensive. It's weird. But I wanted to check it out just because it's a game thing, you know, and that's what I do. And shout out to the old school games we were talking about, Hogue. Here's what I'm talking about. King's Bounty. Fairy Tale.
I don't think I have that one.
Magic. They're all there. They're all the old EA Western RPG games from the Genesis, which is a great.
Folks, if you haven't played King's Bounty, you owe it to yourself to give King's Bounty a try. It's the progenitor to the Heroes of Might and Magic series, which you might be more familiar with. But King's Bounty is fantastic. Check it out.
One of my favorites from back then. Yep. All right. Let's go ahead and wrap up. We will reminder that we're not here next week. I hope everyone has a good Easter, whether you celebrate it or not, just a good weekend. Hopefully we'll be back in 2 weeks' time with the full four of us. Sorry, Rob. It's called Polymega. You can look it up. Rob, check out our retro channel on the Season Gaming Discord. I talk about it there a little bit, but I'll have more on it soon. But we will see you in 2 weeks. Thanks, everyone, for hanging out with us. Thanks, everyone, for bearing with us through all the stuff that's been going on for each of us and trying to get together. We will be back to normal. We will also have, like I said, some guests here in the near future as well that we've wanted to circle back with. So have a good couple of weeks. We'll talk a lot more Dragon's Dogma, maybe some Rise of the Ronin, and whatever else happens here in a couple of weeks. Until then, enjoy your gaming, and we'll see you then.